This is the remix. The Jeeps pump this new remix. This is the remix. Radios play this remix. This is the remix. The clubs pump this remix. This is the remix.
So do you hold on inside? If you wanna be with me, you gotta keep it real. Tell me what's going on, tell me how you feel. Boy, I know you want me just as much as I want you. So come and get my love, all here for you.
Hello everyone, welcome. You're with Shoes in Bitcoin episode 2. Today we are going to talk about Bitcoin, not about shoes. So I have two wonderful guests this evening with me. But before proceeding further, we have to mention that any questions which are on the topic are going to be answered, if not during the conversation, as I have already some questions for my guests today. They're going to be answered respectively the questions afterwards. I'd like to ask everyone to stay on mute. And if you, as I've mentioned, have any questions, just don't hesitate to type them or to send afterwards an email. Your feedback is more than welcome. Being patient with your journey and the learning cycle that you're going to experience with Bitcoin is something very important. So give yourself time. We are stepping in the shoes of not who, but Mir Liponi and David Coen today. So I'm just going to give you guys the words to introduce yourselves and to tell us more about you, Mir. The ladies first.
Okay. Wow, a very difficult question. Who am I? I would say I'm a sort of a walking contradiction, a curious person who really loves to experiment and to try many, many different things in life. And at some point I discovered Bitcoin, but also I decided to stay here as a Bitcoiner because I fell in love with Bitcoin. But previously I've done so many different things. I've done a vocal coach for 10 years. And I was teaching music to kids. I have a degree in linguistic and communication, almost a PhD. I didn't finish it because I fell in love with Bitcoin. I fell in into the rabbit hole. And right now I work for a company called Satoshi Design, and we basically, our goal is to provide services, graphic and design and communication services to Bitcoin-only companies. This is something that I really care about because, Bitcoiner usually don't care about this kind of stuff. And I'm okay with that, but we are professional, so we can give our help and at the same time being Bitcoin maximalist hardcore. So this is our strength. Also, the competences of the people that are working with me are incredible. And so basically, that's what I do nowadays. Also, I'm a mom, so right now my creature is sleeping. so right. I can do this, but lockdown has been very hard for yeah. that.
It must be quite difficult for you to manage all these things in parallel.
Yeah, it's very difficult, and Giacomo is in the other room doing another call, so we have to use the evening and the night and when the baby sleep to do things like that, but we are managing to do anything. It's really required a lot of organization, but we are okay.
We trust in you guys, we are sure you'll make it. And little one is very cute, by the way, so
yeah she's full of joy.
Yeah, everyone who is following you in Instagram,
I can see some picture from there. Yeah.
Great. Okay, David, what about you?
I agree with Mir, it's difficult to say why. My name is David. And I can tell you I consider myself a student most of the time. I can tell you what I'm doing today. I work with Edge Wallet. First, I'm a photographer, a professional photographer, and now I'm trying to change my job. Because of the emergency, because a lot of things I want to reconsider. And I work with Edge Wallet. Edge is a non-custodial wallet. Unfortunately, multi-currency, okay, but that's another point. Okay.
Only Bitcoin, only orange coins, only one coin, no orange coin, sorry.
Okay. I work with Edge like as an IT consultant and in the quality assurance team and as a support consultant. And
quite Bitcoin. Responsible, the quality assurance part.
What?
It must be very...
I cannot hear you.
Again, you're not...
Okay,
getting...
okay, okay, okay.
Okay, okay, great. I was saying that it's a quite responsible role with lots of responsibilities to be quality assurance and to assess specific application which actually serves to such important needs to store value, people's accommodated values and money. So it's a very quite responsible role. Okay, so and what about actually, because right now we are with you, talking to you, David, what about your way? How did you join Bitcoin's industry with this? Edge actually is your first experience with
Bitcoin? No. Well, my journey with Bitcoin started in 2016, but I bought and lost a tiny fraction of Bitcoin and other shitcoin in the year 1 year later. Okay. And then after after I lost all my weight, of course, all my money, I start studying Bitcoin and only Bitcoin.
Because we learn by suffering. This is a rule.
Always.
We
always.
Only learn like that.
Always.
By the way, with whoever I spoke, the majority of people have experienced, firstly, Bitcoin not in a very positive way.
Or
Or
it's just the environment, or not exactly Bitcoin, because the majority of people don't know, unfortunately, yet what really Bitcoin is. And they think that sometimes they're investing in Bitcoin, but actually they're investing in other things, which does not exist. We're not going to talk about scams, maybe one day. There are lots of material for a conversation in that direction. You guys right now, you're completely focused all your lives on Bitcoin only, also from professional and from personal level, because you've experienced the technology, you saw it from all its angles, 360 degrees, and now this is kind of a life, Bitcoin life. My idea is just to understand more about the community, more specifically in Italy. Yesterday, for example, evening, I joined a very nice conversation in Italian. It was one of your meetups. However, I'm not sure I understood everything. Aside from the fact that Bitcoin mass adoption is inevitabile.
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 It's a very, very difficult word. I'm not even sure that I can say properly. Inevitabile. Inevitabile.
Okay. What does it mean? What is your perception? What do you think in that direction? Is there mass adoption? All these wallets, for example, and all these solutions that serve as an opportunity for people to explore what is to be in the crypto assets world. And is the world ready for this mass adoption? If we are so good and we start explaining everywhere that what Bitcoin is and people understand it immediately and want to go in now, are we ready for it?
Well, I can play the skeptical part, and maybe David could be the optimistic guy.
No. Well, the other way.
Well, actually, I really don't like the idea of a mass adoption. It's not that I don't want it, but I don't see that as a goal. I see as a collateral, something that will happen and will really improve some features of Bitcoin. For example, privacy will be very, very much helped by mass adoption. But except for that, I see like mass adoption something taken directly for Silicon Valley, or I don't know, it's just like a term that it's very distant from the Bitcoin community and from everything. Bitcoin is still working without mass adoption, still working pretty well. I don't think we really need it so much, but since Bitcoin, it's incredible by design, and also because the current situation is economically, and not only economically, very dramatic. I think we are going to see something different in the next month and in the next years, something we cannot expect exactly, but this is an opportunity. If it doesn't happen at this point, it probably won't happen. Mm-hmm. Mass adoption. I don't know if Bitcoin is ready, but since I'm here in the space for some years at this point, I have to say that right now we have something like Lightning. We didn't have Lightning only 2-3 years ago. So things really improved, and probably we are going to see many, many changes. People will grow together with Bitcoin, and Bitcoin will adapt to the needs of people. So let's see what happens. It's very interesting. My answer would be very different only 2 months ago, but right now I think mass adoption is closer than we think.
Great. It's only by...
Mir, you are the optimistic here.
Yeah, I am optimistic. I'm only skeptical. I'm skeptical because I don't like the idea of we really need mass adoption, but in the end, it's going to happen, and it's going to be good
somehow.
Somehow, so you can be the pessimistic guy at this point. If you want to, you're free to go.
Right. You mentioned Lightning. Just to make sure, yep. Lightning. This is kind of this second layer technology,
yep.
Which enables faster transactions.
Yeah, more private. Yes, I think the most interesting part is that because when you are on the second layer, you are not using directly the blockchain, and we know that blockchain is a public ledger. So a public ledger means that we can still see the transaction and what is happening. But when you do things, I explained this very basically, when you do a transaction with channels, you are not doing directly on the blockchain. So it's very much private and also very, very fast, because for the same reason, you are not going to transact using all the mechanism around the blockchain and the mining part of Bitcoin. So super fast, super private, It's the best.
And it enables people to make these transactions faster and also businesses to integrate this solution.
Yeah, it's easier to integrate that, and also it's very good for small amounts. So when you have small amounts and use Bitcoin, it's not great because you are going to pay many fees if you are using Bitcoin, using the blockchain of Bitcoin, but with Lightning, it's cheaper too.
Okay, great. Thank you. And David, what about your opinion in that direction?
The mass adoption?
Yeah.
First of all, Bitcoin is not a product.
Okay.
We tend to think about mass adoption because we see, as Mir suggested, we see the, you know, the product, the development of a specific sector, like, for example, smartphones and so on. So when we start to think about Bitcoin as a protocol and as an asset, we start divide these two kind of things. When you think about the protocol, you can see a lot of new development, for example, Lightning Network. And with Lightning Network, we will see a lot of new adoption and, most of all, a lot of new kind of transaction we didn't have before. A lot of new services. For example,
And the demand will be naturally created within the environment, potentially.
Yeah, potentially, yes. And when you think about Bitcoin as an asset, as a monetary asset, the answer you should, the question you should ask yourself is, do I need Bitcoin? When you need Bitcoin, you have adoption. If you don't need Bitcoin, you don't have adoption. Today we have a new situation. We don't know how US dollar will act in the future, in the near future, but we see, for example, other cases like Venezuela, like other places in which they use Bitcoin as an asset and as a protocol because they need Bitcoin. Okay.
In what sense? Could you please tell us this is a very...
For example, in Venezuela, people who work remotely, they are paid in Bitcoin sometimes, and they sell Bitcoins for US dollar because they cannot buy US dollar from outside exchanges. But only from internal exchanges.
This is legally the legal regulation within the Venezuela.
I don't know about regulation. I know that people trade Bitcoin for US dollar inside the country because they want US dollar now for the moment. Okay, but they need somehow Bitcoin today. Maybe we don't need Bitcoin today. I mean, I need Bitcoin, okay, but do you need Bitcoin?
I think that many think that they don't need it, but they will discover it very soon.
Probably.
I just tweeted something like that today.
They don't need it because to need something you have to realize.
And they are going to realize when there are going to be many intervention from the government, because in Italy they are starting to talk about taxes on our wealth, patrimoniale, or for example, prelievi forzosi, which means they withdrawal money directly from our bank accounts. Probably people would understand that our money is not our money. And there are instruments like Bitcoin where our money is our money. Our value is still our value. It doesn't change so much over time because we are talking about how much Bitcoin is volatile. But actually, with this hyperinflation that we're going to see in the next month, I think we are going to experience something like, the volatility of Bitcoin was nothing in comparison of what we are going to face. Because even in this moment, our 10 euros are going to value less every day. And at least Bitcoin can go up and can go down. But with inflation, you only go down. It's very dramatic. And I think many will realize like that. And it's very interesting because I'm positive in that with the need, people will also learn to use technology very fast. For example, see how many people are now using Zoom. My mother was in the 80s year old today, told me, I'm going to meet my friend using Zoom. I was like, really? She's great. She can use the technology. But it's impossible to think even 2-3 months ago. I know Zoom is very easy, but there are applications for Bitcoin too. They are kind of easy. And also yesterday, somebody during the meetup told us something very funny. If people arranged to get into the IMS site and ask for the money, they can eventually learn to use Bitcoin because it's easier than that. So that's so much true. So the very point is you have to need Bitcoin and you have to understand that it's something scarce and it is something that it's that has a value. After that, the technology is not so difficult. Of course, the most difficult part is to make people understand that with great powers there are great responsibilities. Yeah. It's not easy. It's not something that we really want to have responsibility. We have to save our keys. We have to do many things. And we cannot ask somebody else to do that, which is very comfortable. I can ask my banker to do stuff. I can call him or I can call the customer care of PayPal if I want to. But with Bitcoin, when going to call Satoshi Nakamoto, he's not going to answer. So it's not something so easy to think about that, that we really need with Bitcoin to take our responsibilities for our wealth.
There is not something like information, like a hub official made that you have to dig your nose a lot in order to actually. Oh, really? Yeah. I mean, if a person does not is not introduced properly in an environment, it's pretty possible to get lost in it.
As I said before, you learn by suffering. Right now, the suffering is less and less every day. When we enter into Bitcoin, there were no resources around. There was basically Reddit or IRC chat or things like that. So right now you can find, the resources are scattered around. There are many. It's not clear the path, but there are plenty. If somebody wants to, and we still have internet, we can find a way. But back in the time, it wasn't like that. So we really need to learn by suffering a lot in every possible way. But also for people entering now, they are going to suffer a little bit. So it's better to try stuff in testnet or try stuff probably only with very, very small amount because... It's still super easy.
And for example, you're saying that there are already user-friendly software that can be...
Yeah, well, I've tried some Lightning wallet. And I think they are not so difficult to use. Phoenix, for example, is kind of easy to use. And many wallets, Bitcoin wallet right now are not difficult to use. It's just, it takes probably less than some hours to understand what's going on. So,
So I've had the pleasure to install several days ago Green Wallet.
And it's easy.
Yeah, it's easy, but I wanted with one of our previous speakers, Valeriya Vaccaro. Yeah. To bounce some bitcoins and to make it as an example to all the attendees of this webinar and the group in Facebook. And the only thing I don't like, because sometimes I'm downloading some applications just to explore what they have inside. Is there something new? And I all these 24 words and all these seeds and words.
You can try edge. Try edge words.
Okay, so a very good selling point. Just try edge wallet. Security.
Yeah, because sometimes it's a matter of the feature and sometimes it's just the user experience. Yeah. There are user experience better for some people, other better for other people. They are just implemented in a way very similar to my way of thinking and interacting. So I'm totally okay. I don't think there are best wallets if we exclude security and the feature, technical feature. Of course, there are better wallet than other, but except for that, if we just talking about the user experience or basic feature, if it's not a custodian wallet, yes. Of course, and it's plenty of them. Except for that, they are kind of similar, so they can adapt to the user. User can download many and try the best one for them. I think that the most difficult part is actually what you were saying before. Well, it's about the fact that you have to enter into the mindset of the seed that you have this seed and you have to write it down and you have to save it very carefully. And it's something you haven't experienced before and you're like, oh, this is not so important. I just want to use the app. No, it's the most important part. Yep. Of all, because a wallet is not real. A wallet is just like
an interface.
Yes, it's an interface. It's something that helps you managing your keys. The wallet is not a very good word. In Italian, I would suggest that portachiavi is probably better than portafoglio. But when you realize that, it's better. Okay, I'm managing my keys, and keys are something very important and help me entering something with value. I think it's a better term, because if you think about wallet, you think just something when you put your Bitcoin in and you put your Bitcoin down, but it's not working like that actually. But yes, after the seed part, everything it's easier. Right.
That's why you guys tend to say not your keys, not your
coins.
Absolutely.
Okay, so it's very important, these 24 words are the most important thing.
Yeah, in Italy we had something, I don't know if it exists anymore, il libretto al portatore.
Yeah.
It is something very similar. The keys are contained directly there. You own anything with that product. It doesn't exist anymore. Probably I had one when I was a kid, but it's something that we have as a concept, but we don't use it anymore. Yeah.
Right.
So if you think about our private key as gold.
Okay.
You are in the correct mindset. For example, you cannot store your gold in the public space. You take your gold and you put it in your safer place at home.
Yeah.
Private key is like a piece of gold.
Yeah.
And that's why I have something here on security, because you're mentioning several times it's security.
Cannot hear you.
You cannot hear me. I'm sorry.
Okay, perfect.
I'm really sorry for that.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So about the security of Bitcoin, I want to know how secure actually it is to have Bitcoin, to invest in Bitcoin. And is Bitcoin attackable?
Yeah.
And in what circumstances?
Well, I have to say that it's very relative, the first part. It's safe, it's secure, but I don't recommend investing more that you okay, we lose. So really depends on your wealth. For a small amount of your wealth, it's totally okay and it's totally safe. But it's still an experiment and we are still in the early phases. We love Bitcoin, it's something incredible. and we really trust Bitcoin. We are trusting Bitcoin, buying it and holding it. Of course, we think it's safe, it's scarce, it's our digital gold. But at the same time, we see many flows of Bitcoin, and I think it's still attackable in many ways. In some way, Bitcoin is not attackable because by design, Satoshi thought of some kind of attacks, a double spending attack, for example, the most famous. But there are plenty of attacks. There could be small bugs. There could be social attacks. We have seen so many social attacks, political attacks from behind, trying to change Bitcoin. And there are probably different kind of attack when you... a fraud kind of attack, trying to get people getting your Bitcoin. The only person who is going to lose Bitcoin is you. And you can, as we were saying before, you can attack Bitcoin by yourself doing stupid stuff. Yeah. So it's there are plenty of way to attack Bitcoin. But every day we know. More stuff about Bitcoin every day. Bitcoin is stronger, and I think it's very healthy. All the attack we have seen in the past, especially the social attacks and the technical attacks, really help at Bitcoin. My concern is that, and I'm talking about all the Bitcoin wars that have been played in the last years. My concern is that at some point we really think that Bitcoin is invincible. It is, but we don't know. So we still have to work, especially technical people, to prevent and to imagine how to react to future attacks. I didn't want to talk about the pandemic, but one comparison could be just like right now, many people, government and authorities are telling us we couldn't expect something like that. No, you should prepare for a pandemic because it's something that could happen. And in the same way, Bitcoiners should be ready for hypothetical scenarios. And even in peaceful moments, right, like that, they should... the technical guys, but also the normal guys, normies just like me, because using the products and sometimes asking dumb questions, maybe we can really help. We put all of us together and telling the people who are maintaining the protocol, what is working, what is not working, and whatever. So I think that since we are in very early phases, anything could happen, and we should be ready. Of course, we cannot be ready in any possible way, but this community is full of very smart people. And what happened, for example, during the USF attack was incredible. It was something totally epic, and Bitcoin is stronger than before.
SF, what does it stand for? This is, by the way,
user activated the soft fork. It's okay. My hat over there.
What happened?
Well, if I have to explain that in a very small word, is very small details, it was a bet. A USF is just was a way to threaten in some way the miners, not to change the history of the Bitcoin, to please activate SegWit's implementation with the software, otherwise all the community would have activated for them. So we didn't need to do the user activated soft fork, but everybody downloaded and ran the full node to be ready to eventually do that. So the community was stronger than miners. And the funny fact is that after that, the fork of Bitcoin was created, the Bitcoin Cash fork was created. So in the end, everybody was happy because the people who really wanted another kind of Bitcoin at their kind of Bitcoin, they were sure that that was the best Bitcoin and all the network would converge over there, but didn't happen. And also the miners learned that community and user are very, very strong in Bitcoin. So it was kind of epic also all the other wars. As I was saying before, we cannot think that Bitcoin is stronger than it is only because we won some wars, but who knows. I'm scared.
Several battles, but the final.
I think that the vectors could be right now the most dangerous vectors could be represented by the governments or from political attacks. So nothing like that really happened. Of course, media attacked Bitcoin. Of course, there are plenty of people talking about Bitcoin in a bad way. Regulators trying to stop Bitcoin in some part of the world or making things not so easy to do, for example, blocking bank accounts or creating legislation against Bitcoin, laws against Bitcoin. But for now, we can say that governments cannot tolerate Bitcoin. So,
right.
Easy part, still in the right. Easy phase.
I'm seeing recently, because I'm reading all day during the majority of time, and they see lots of countries are making kind of internal experiments to check the environment. They started launching such projects, or at least this is what is in the media about, like for example, China, their own digital cash. But most probably people, I'm not sure they understand the difference about federated and unfederated blockchains, what we
will
be exactly.
Yeah. Definitely not.
Well, we have to say that it's not very easy to understand.
That's why it's us. So we are going to explain it. I'm personally, I like it. I like Bitcoin. I'm very enthusiastic about this. I believe it's the future. And I believe in the mass adoption in a natural way. So this is the...
Very nice, in a natural way. I love it.
The natural way, but with some help, robots and artificial intelligence, help from the robots. Okay. Davita, what do you think, being part of the community since some time and also being in constant collaboration with Mir and other people from the community, can you tell me what is the approximate deviation between male and female? Do we have enough presence of ladies in this environment within the community?
Mm. I don't know the reason. I don't look at the if a person is a male or female. I know a lot of women that are incredible developers. I know a lot of male that are super cute and super smart. I never look at this as a problem.
Right.
I don't know.
I think also that the fact is that Bitcoin is permissionless. So when you enter into Bitcoin, you are totally natural. You are just a user of Bitcoin.
Yeah.
So this is something incredible. Doesn't happen in any kind of scenario, system, situation. So this could be really an opportunity for women. But of course, the community is composed by the percentage are. I checked some years ago, it was just like 94% men and 6% of women. But I think people don't understand that it's very difficult to understand it, because many accounts, for example, have pseudonym in Bitcoin. So you don't know if it's even on Twitter or on people participating in the community. So I know at least two people there who think they are male, but they're actually women. So, for example, so I think as an impact as a community, I mean, my perception is that it's something where we shouldn't really care so much about. Yeah. But if you're a woman, I would suggest that don't participate in probably things that are for women only, because it's just like saying I'm good and I'm interested only because I'm a woman. And I would say I want to be here because I'm a curious person, I'm building something, I have some merits, not because I am a woman. Yeah, exactly. It could be, but also at the same time, I'm not so against some we'll say ideas and ways to include women. And in my experience, I mean, inclusion for everyone, it's good. And this is totally from my experience. One way to catch women and to interest women is to start from the why of Bitcoin. Women are really fast in understanding why we need Bitcoin. And men, usually, this is not a rule, of course. It's just a generalization and comes from my experience. But men are more interested in the economic part of Bitcoin, in the tech behind Bitcoin. And women are super fast in getting why we need Bitcoin. If you start with that, you get attention. And they are super, super interested and the strongest Bitcoin supporter, for sure. But of course, that was a generalization because, for example, I like very much the tech behind Bitcoin, so I really like that part. So probably with me, it really worked that part pretty fast too. But I mean, it's just the same. It's just like a prioritization of the goals. Start with the why. Why we need Bitcoin? Bitcoin is great for human rights. Bitcoin is something we really need because. If we want to be our own bank, it works better. Okay.
Valeriya.
We lost you.
Yeah.
You lost me again.
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Ah, I can be well. This is not good. Thank you guys. I'm sorry. So I'm just relating to the past personally to me. When 10, 11 years ago, when I for the first time joined a tech company, the majority of the people were men, and they step by step, due to the soft skills and project management, more easy from technical perspective jobs, because I don't know, personally, at my age, I know some software developers, women, but not so many, for sure. And me personally, I'm making an experiment. I'm challenging myself, and as of tomorrow, I've subscribed for a free Python developing course at Stanford. There is something for free here.
Yeah, great.
So let's see.
Yeah. I really wanted to do computer science when I was 19 years old. But many people discouraged me and told me, oh, you're a woman. You're not supposed to do something like that. It wasn't not so long ago, but people really have some prejudice about that. And since I was only 19 years old, I told myself, probably I'm not good at it. If everyone is telling me so, I shouldn't do that. And also, I would add that Bitcoin is as the mix of male-dominated fields. If you think about finance, technology, computer science, economics are all male dominated, and the intersection game theory. Oh my God. So if you get all of this together, the intersection is very, very small and narrow, and you get less and less women, but women are are just users. When you understand that you are a user into the Bitcoin protocol, into the Bitcoin network, it doesn't matter anymore. It's perfect for everyone. So in the end, even for that, we're going to see many different changes. For example, right now we cannot say that women are not using the email or Zoom or whatever application less than men or things like that. So
It's a neutral technology. You should not look at the gender.
Because I am asking you this question, guys, because I have a dedicated shows in Bitcoin to women in technology, women to learning more, but I'm also inviting men, and with making this let's say logo or a message that I want to send to the people, I just want to let them know that we speak on a basic language and they will be capable to understand that we are talking about. So let's see where these shoes are going to lead us to. So I'm definitely positive about Bitcoin, and I have lots of things to learn. I will keep inviting people like you who are from the environment in order to share their experiences, their journeys in Bitcoin. David, by the way, I know that aside from the fact you're a great developer.
I'm not a developer.
sorry. My bad. Photographer and quality assurance consultant at Edge. You have your book. You have created published your book for Bitcoin. Can you tell us more about it?
I wrote this book. It's a question and answer about Bitcoin. We have the English version, the Italian version, and the Spanish version. Inside, you can find Giacomo Zucco mini me,
who is look like our daughter, actually.
Yeah, I want to show you.
Okay, please.
Okay, can you see?
Okay. Very cute, yeah. And you painted it?
No, a friend of mine.
Ah, okay.
A great woman and a great person. She gave me this drawing for free.
Oh,
great! Very nice from her. Yeah. How big is it? How many pages is your book? And basically, what are we going to learn there? All the questions about Bitcoin or only the foundation ones, or
It's a book that starts with the concept of digital cash.
Okay.
In the Italian version is specified that we usually tend to call Bitcoin digital money, la moneta Bitcoin. Okay, but we should call it electronic cash or digital cash, because it's contante Bitcoin, okay? And
denaro, no denaro.
No, contante. Okay. It's another thing. Denaro is like moneta, is like money, the money concept, okay? When you talk about cash, you think about something you can keep with you.
Yeah, it's exactly, like paper, money, or
coin, metal
coins,
coin.
Yeah, and metal coins.
Yeah, and start with that, and it's a text for newcomers and for advanced user, because we talk about nodes, we talk about the LMPVP concept, Mir loves.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody else really love it.
No, Mir.
Step
by step. So it's readable. I mean, everybody who is such
you can go.
Yeah, can I say something? I really love the book. It's one of my favorite, actually, because it has at the same time the basic concept and the intermediate and advanced concept, and there is almost anything you need, everything you need around Bitcoin, because I really not love the choice of the questions, because I come back to the book from time to time just to because Bitcoin is so complicated. Even I'm studying it since years. So sometimes I forget stuff completely. And this book is short in every answers, but it's very complete in all the topics. So I start with that. I clear my mind, and then I can go back and study something else in a deeper way. So I totally recommend it. I'm just it's just a personal opinion, and I really 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 use it from time to time, and I have the Italian version, but I think the English version is really great too. So
thank you very much, Mir.
No, it's true. There's plenty of Bitcoin books right now. Not plenty, but there are many. I think there are, everyone has their value, my favorites are probably the Bitcoin money. I always start with that because the tale about Bitcoin. Yours for sure, Q&A about Bitcoin, and I really love another one that is completely different than the 21 lessons by Georgieva, because it's something different, completely different from this one. And I have to say, Grokking Bitcoin is very technical, and I totally recommend it, because it's don't start with that, but if you want to go deep down, it's super well made.
Definitely. I'm going to make, by the way, after these days, a list with all these recommendations, and I'm
well, those are my favorites.
David, do you plan to have this translated in Bulgarian or in Romanian, or
if you for Romanian, I was contacted by a guy who asked me to translate it, but with all this mess around, we didn't talk each other, but yes, I would like to have a lot of other translation.
I'm sure if we translate it, the mass adoption will be speeded up.
Cool.
No, absolutely, absolutely.
Let's translate it, Valeriya.
Okay, sure. Noted. I start like a
little. I don't have money because I lost every Bitcoin in 2017.
In a boat accident. I know.
Yeah.
No. I don't know how.
You don't like even this.
Know. Like this. Some scam Ponzi style website, yeah, probably. Valeriya?
Do you hear me?
Okay. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm really sorry for that.
Don't worry, but I think that it's just like everybody is using Zoom these days. So.
Probably.
Yeah, so it's not as easy as it was in the past.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I wanted, Mir, to ask you, I was wondering here, how is to live with Giacomo Zucco, one of the biggest stars and the grandest influencers in this community, Bitcoin community?
It's a total mess. That was an incredible...
Oh, no, I don't know. Only on books or some kind of servers or what's going? Full notes? Only full notes?
Just a giant mess around. And since I'm a very, I'm a planner and a kind of organized person, in the end, we compensate each other. So as you can see, there is nothing terrible around because we are very, very different for that part. And so we really complete each other. But since we've been together since 2001, at this point is almost 20 years. Bitcoin is an important chapter, but it's just another adventure that we are sharing together. Probably one of the most beautiful, and it's one of the biggest adventure. And of course, we talk about Bitcoin a lot at home since the first day. And I'm very lucky because we can speak a lot, and I can ask directly to Giacomo many stuff and many doubts I have, and sometimes I contribute too. we plan, and we have to really start to write our own books. Our own book, and right now there is only the summary, and even in this case we are going to complement each other in the way that Giacomo is a very analytic person and I'm a very synthetic person, so he's going to write a chapter and I'm going to synthesize this, going to do the synthesis at the end of every chapter. And also I'm good at doing research because I was previously researcher for university, so I'm good with sources or things like that. And Giacomo is very good in argumentation and creating and writing and all that part. So I think it's going to be an interesting project, and also this time together in quarantine can really help. But actually we didn't start yet because it's not so easy, but that's our plan. Probably in the last next year we are going to publish that book.
That's great. So I think that we have some piccante news in shows. Mozzuffo and Mir Liponi are starting their own book. They're complimenting each other.
Yeah. Well, I cannot play Giacomo and Giacomo cannot play Mir, but we can help each other, of course. Yeah. Sometimes I'm jealous because I want to be Giacomo, but I'm not Giacomo. And it's super stupid because I'm a different person and I have different skills, different experience, and I can contribute to Bitcoin in different way. For example, I was telling before, for example, I think I can synthesize things better than Giacomo, and I can communicate better with people basic stuff of Bitcoin, but only because I'm more basic as a user and as a person, so it's easier for me. And then Giacomo knows Bitcoin better than me and in a more complicated way, so.
Right, but you are a perfect team, so
I like to see that in this way. Let's see what other people think about the book, but it's still a work in progress.
Yeah, we are patient, we're going to wait for
probably it's going to be the mass adoption,
naturally,
before
mass adoption.
Yeah,
okay, great. So we have 3 more minutes, and I would like just to ask you to give me your sentence, like individuals from your own personalities. Why Bitcoin? Why Bitcoin?
Well, there are plenty of reasons why we need Bitcoin. And I think that the most interesting part of Bitcoin is just like, Bitcoin is a mirror in a way. And one of the most interesting part of Bitcoin is giving us the freedom and financial freedom and liberty and great stuff. But also the most interesting part that we can learn about ourselves in using Bitcoin and going down into the rabbit hole. So it's mirroring our needs and our path of as a Bitcoiner. So the path to journeys is even better than Bitcoin itself.
Great, thanks, Mir. David?
Why Bitcoin? It's hard because, why Bitcoin? Because it's, I can control my own money. Mm-hmm. It's a scarce asset because it's something different than what we saw before. Mm-hmm. It's a totally different system. It's a trustless protocol if you talk about Bitcoin protocol and not the asset. It's something you should study because it really open your mind.
Definitely, I can confirm this, and especially I'm very surprised from the fact that I can buy shoes without being censored. I love it.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
Valeriya.
Okay. Better? Is it better? Thank you very much.
Yeah.
People in Zoom.
You.
This is sabotage. I'm joking. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you,
Valeriya.
I think it was a huge pleasure. Hope to see you again.
Sure.
Thank you, Mir. Thank you, Valeriya.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
This is the remix. The Jeeps pump this new remix. This is the remix. Radios play this remix. This is the remix. The clubs pump this remix. This is the remix.
Gotta keep it real. Tell me what's going on. Tell me how you feel. Boy, I know you want me just as much as I want you to come and get my love. All here for you.
Shaking thighs, all I'm trying to do in the hood is stay alive. Make a little money with Destiny Child. Thugs hear the song and the dance, they go wild like Texas. They moving like no limit soldiers. It went from a dream to the young supreme singing girls.
No, 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 no. When it's right, yeah.